Hi folks. In this presentation, we'll look at transposons and at transposition in more detail, revelations that followed well after McClintock's discoveries. If repetitive DNA is much of a eukaryotic genome, and if transposons are a large part of repetitive DNA, then any understanding of what a genome looks like, and how it came to look that way, requires an understanding of what transposons are, how they behave, and how they have influenced genome and therefore species evolution. All this will be covered here, beginning with type 2 or DNA transposons. Bacterial insertion sequences, or IS elements, were the first mobile elements discovered in the 1960s after McClintock's maize AC and DS mobile genetic elements. Because they share features of eukaryotic transposons, and because they can carry antibiotic resistance genes, we'll take a brief look at IS elements and other bacterial transposons, including TNs, and even some bacteriophage that can function as a transposon or alternatively as a virus. So IS elements were described in some detail through the 1970s. There are now many known IS elements, and they tend to be named things like IS1, IS2, IS3, and so on. While they can be shown or made to transpose, IS elements are generally silent when found in bacteria. This is because prokaryotic genomes are compact, unlike the seemingly bloated eukaryotic genomes, so that rampant transposition in a bacterial cell would be expected to have a far greater likelihood of mutating some essential gene, in which case the cell wouldn't survive to tell the tale of transposition. On the other hand, we know that some bacterial transposons have inserted into some well-known genes, for example, those of the lac operon. Recall the role of the lac operon genes, and then explain how this could have happened without killing the cell. Try to come up with an explanation on your own. So let's look at the structure of a typical IS element. As it says, they range in length from about 750 to a little more than 1400 base pairs. They contain transposase and resolvase genes, which code for enzymes necessary for mobility. At either end of the IS element are inverted repeats, which are part of the IS element structure, and they are also essential for mobility. Genetically engineered elements that lack or have mutated inverted repeats cannot transpose. Wherever they insert, IS elements are also flanked by direct repeats. These are not part of the element itself, but are footprints of insertion in the target DNA, either genomic DNA or plasmid DNA. These direct repeats result from the mechanism of transposition. Again, because of their compact genomes, bacteria can only tolerate low copy numbers of IS elements or other transposons in their genome. If a pair of IS elements should come to lie close to one another, they could be separated by a relatively short stretch of genomic or plasmid DNA. The IS elements and the DNA between them could then become a composite transposon, or a TN element, that can transpose as a unit. As you see here, TN elements on plasmids, for example, typically contain antibiotic resistance genes. These genes will travel along with the IS elements when the TN transposes. When found on an F or fertility plasmid, antibiotic resistance genes can be transferred during conjugation, which is a kind of mating that occurs between compatible bacterial mating types. Subsequent transposition of the TN from the plasmid to the bacterial genome after conjugation would be facilitated by the products of the transposase and resolvase genes in the IS regions of the TN element. These, in fact, are principal pathways for the transfer and spread of antibiotic resistance between bacteria. So-called complex transposons look a bit like a TN element, but usually contain many genes in addition to those necessary for mobility. Those are the yellow boxes in this illustration. Now, some complex transposons resemble a bacteriophage, and mu is in fact a bacterial virus which can function either as a transposon moving within the bacterial genome or as a phage, able to lyse the cell and infect new cells. So let's take just a moment to look at the alternate pathways of bacteriophage infection in general. So here we have a phage particle off to the left approaching a bacterium. So the first thing that happens is the phage particle attaches to the surface of the bacterial cell. The phage DNA then moves into the cell, and the phage can then enter either the lytic or lysogenic pathway. Let's look at the lytic pathway first. The lytic pathway begins when the phage DNA is transcribed and proteins are translated that will replicate the viral DNA, and you're looking at the replication of the viral DNA. Next, viral coat proteins will package the DNA into infectious phage particles that accumulate and eventually burst from the cell. This is lysis. All right, alternatively, after attaching to the bacterial cell, the phage can instead undergo lysogeny. In this case, after the DNA is in the infected cell, it approaches the bacterial chromosome. After it integrates into the bacterial genome, the phage DNA will replicate along with the bacterial chromosome. This is the lysogenic pathway. If adverse environmental conditions stress the bacterium, the integrated phage can excise from the chromosome and re-enter the lytic pathway, thus escaping a possibly painful fate of the bacterium. Okay, now let's look at the added option for bacteriophage mu. The upper pathway is similar to the lytic pathway for other bacteriophage. Mu can also enter the lysogenic pathway, as shown in the lower part of the illustration. And mu, like other phage, can excise itself and re-enter the lytic pathway under appropriate conditions. Or, once excised, it can instead transpose to other locations in the bacterial chromosome. Like the excision and resumption of lytic activity, transposon activity is often correlated with stress. As we turn to a description of eukaryotic transposons, watch for similarities to the prokaryotic transposons, IS and TN elements, etc. Type 1 transposons, or retrotransposons, move or jump by transcription of RNA at one locus, at a home locus you can call it, followed by reverse transcription and integration of the cDNA into DNA regions at different locations. As we'll see, retrotransposons may be derived from or even the source of retroviruses, which also excise from and integrate into DNA. The type 2 transposons are DNA transposons. These move by one of two mechanisms, either cut and paste or replication. So cut and paste transposons move by leaving one locus and integrating into another. Transposons that move by a replicative mechanism are essentially copied, and the copies integrate into new target site DNA, leaving the original transposon in place. By the way, mu is an example of a replicative type 2 transposon in a prokaryote. Okay, this table summarizes different kinds of transposons with well-studied examples, their distribution, and some of their known properties. You don't need to look at this here, but you may wish to have a copy of this table in front of you when you study the different examples to be presented here. And this table highlights the fact that in eukaryotes, transposons can range from as little as 3% of a bacterial genome to as much as 45 to even 95% of eukaryotic genomes. In fact, at 4% and 6% of the genome, transposons in Drosophila, the fruit fly, and rice, respectively, are at the lowest proportions. Given that most higher organisms have way more DNA than they need to encode their genes, a question that most fascinates me is why do the genomes of some higher organisms seem to tolerate, even make use of transposition, and others not? It's like the fruit fly has opted out, resisting the temptations of jumping genes. There's no answer to these questions yet. Okay, now let's take a look at some examples of eukaryotic transposon structure and mechanisms of transposition. Active eukaryotic class 2 or DNA transposons share key features with the bacterial IS and TN elements, as well as complex transposons in bacteria, including flanking inverted repeats and genes required for transposition, for example, the transposase gene. Like the bacterial elements, they also leave a pair of flanking direct repeats of host cell DNA at the insertion site. Note that the ends of eukaryotic transposons do not include any independent mobile elements analogous to the bacterial IS elements. So now let's look at a general description of the cut and paste mechanism of type 2 DNA transposon mobility. After transcription and translation of the transposase gene that's not shown in this illustration, the enzyme's endonuclease activity hydrolyzes the ends of transposons, leaving staggered ends, somewhat like bacterial at restriction endonucleases that we so commonly use in recombinant DNA research. The transposon is thus liberated from its locus in the genome, you see that at the right of this illustration, and at the same time, The genomic DNA can come back together because of those complementary staggered ends. DNA polymerase next fills in the missing nucleotides, basically an example of DNA repair. DNA ligase then completes the repair of the genomic DNA. Transposase, in the meantime, binds the cut ends of the transposon, causing it to form a circular structure shown here. In this configuration, the transposase can attack or cleave target DNA and ligate one strand of the target DNA to one end of the transposon, at the same time trimming back the 3' end of the other target DNA strand. With the transposase still hanging on, the next step is ligation of one strand at the other end of the transposon to the target DNA, and a similar trim back of the 3' hydroxy end of the other target DNA strand. In the final steps, DNA polymerase fills in the missing bases, and DNA ligase completes the paste part of the transposition. Fill-in of the bases at either end of the inserted element complete creation of the direct repeats characteristic of transposition. Now let's look at a general description of the replication-based mechanism of DNA transposon mobility. We start with our transposon ready to jump. Mobility begins with transposase-catalyzed cleavage and hydrolytic trimming of host DNA at the transposon locus. But this time, the transposon is not excised from its resident site. Instead, the transposase indeed holds the transposon in a circular configuration, but with the genomic DNA still attached. In the next step, the transposase enables two free 3' hydroxyl ends of the transposon to attack or hydrolyze the double-stranded target site, and then ligate each cut end of the transposon strand to the different cut ends of the target DNA strands. The result of ligation leaves the original transposon in place as part of a structure called the cointegrate. In the cointegrate, the original and replicated transposons are aligned by folding of the genomic DNA. As a result of forming this cointegrate, you get an internal chromosome alignment of the two elements, and the DNA can undergo recombination by one of two mechanisms. And the result is resolution of the cointegrate and the duplication of short target site DNAs that are the direct repeat footprints of transposition. So let's summarize. First, let's look at the similarities and then the differences between cut and paste and replicative transposition. The common features are at the start of the transposition pathway. Transposase catalyzes single-stranded hydrolysis and trim back to leave staggered overlapping ends. Now let's look at the differences. In cut and paste transposition, transposase catalyzes second-strand cleavage to release the transposon from its resident DNA. The enzyme keeps the transposon ends together, effectively creating a circular structure. The enzyme, together with the free circularized transposon, catalyzes the cleavage of the target site DNA to begin insertion. The main thing here is that no cointegrate forms. Compare this to replicative transposition. The transposon is sort of circularized, but while it is still linked to and part of the resident site DNA, the transposase, bound to this partially circularized structure, catalyzes the invasion of target site DNA to begin insertion and the formation of a cointegrate. The cointegrate is a transient structure that must be resolved by one of two recombination mechanisms. All right, replicative transposition is clearly pretty complex. And with that understatement, we end this presentation.